We'll check out Kamehameha.
We'll find out what happens when the Fort Worth Zoo visits the library.
And we'll visit Fiberfest 2018.
All this and more coming up about town.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to About Town. I'm Susan Kamyov.
And I'm Kathy Whiteman, and I'm glad that Susan is back with us again this week.
Yeah.
So you've been busy with the festivals. I know that DIFF, the Dallas International Film Festival, wrapped up a bit ago. Find anything you liked?
Yeah, I really like Blind Spotting, which I'll talk about later in the show. Got to interview the stars of that one. And Bo Burnham's new film, Eighth Grade.
Okay, I'm scared. Eighth graders scare me. It must be a horror film.
No, it's a comedy, kind of dark a little.
All right, so be interested to hear what you have to say about Blind Spotting, too.
Yeah.
I love David Diggs.
Yeah.
So we're glad that you joined us for details today on Canal Fest 2018.
We'll also find out about the new production, Juneteenth, the stage play, later in the show.
As always, we'd love to hear from you. Let us know if there's a community event that you'd like to promote on the show or a story you'd like to see us cover.
You can email us at ictn@cityofirving.org or connect with us on social media. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. We'd love to hear from you.
For more than 30 years, the Irving Schools Foundation has celebrated the excellence of Irving ISD students and teachers at the annual Breakfast with the Stars. Here are some highlights in this week's Arts Review.
The brightest of Irving ISD walked the red carpet at the 31st annual Breakfast with the Stars, held at the Irving Convention Center.
Today we actually have 184 scholarships that we're awarding, totaling almost $500,000.
A record-breaking guest count of nearly 900 people were in attendance this year to cheer on some of Irving's best as they received their scholarships.
What I love about our scholarships are not just based on academics, they're based on, are you a great person? Are you going to go out in the community and make a difference? And so that's really what's unique about our scholarships, I believe. A neat thing we're adding this year, which we've never done before, this year they're actually going to be sharing their stories. So every 25 kids or so, we're going to have a student get up there and share their story about their lives and what got them to where they are today. And then they're going to share their next step.
And now I will be attending to the University of Texas at Austin to become a robotic engineer.
Returning as MC for his 15th year, Dr. John McKay of WFAA also gave some breaking news.
This just in. The Irving Schools Foundation is proud to announce that every single one of today's student, staff, and teacher scholarship recipients will be receiving an additional $1,000.
The surprise announcement brought joy and tears to the room.
This event every year is the tearjerker. And not that we try and do that on purpose, but it is. It's just naturally that way because people love watching these kids up on stage talking about their future.
Congratulations to all the recipients of this year's Breakfast with the Stars. For About Town, this is Susan Kamyov.
To find out how you can help support Irving ISD students, visit IrvingSchoolsFoundation.org. If you're a fan of Japanese anime, chances are you found your way to a Kamehameha at the Irving Convention Center at Las Colinas in early May. You didn't make it? Well, here's a look at all the fun.
It's the first convention of its kind in the DFW area. Dragon Ball Z fans united for Kamehameha here at the Irving Convention Center.
Kamehameha brought together fans from all over the world.
We came from all the way from Alabama. We drove through the night to get here and pretty tired, but you know, we're having a good time out here.
So many people here are from like so far. Someone's here from Barcelona.
Some fans came dressed as their favorite characters.
Piccolo, he's basically a protector of the earth. He used to be a bad guy back in Dragon Ball. One of the coolest characters, not the most powerful, but he always seems to kind of stick with the crew, no matter how powerful they get.
Beerus is actually like a male character, and he is a god of destruction. So I just kind of like, I have this Napoleon kind of complex with myself where it's like, I'm so small and weak, but when I cosplay, I can be so powerful.
While others came to work.
We sell everything from airsoft, cosplay, real swords, pocket knives, wands.
We have the Dragon Ball Z Spear Bomb energy drinks. It's all the energy in the universe down in this little can right here. It comes in blueberry flavor.
It kind of sucks that I'm working because I really want to walk around. But yeah, I mean, I got to do what I got to do.
But they all share the same passion.
I'm a Dragon Ball Z fan. I've been a fan like my whole life. You know, I watched the cartoon as a kid growing up, you know. after school every day.
I grew up with Dragon Ball Z. I was drawing Dragon Ball Z pictures when I was in 7th and 8th grade back in 98.
I love it just because like it's such good vibes, just like happy vibes, and you can do anything, and every episode's just kind of like, you just have to believe in yourself. Friendship is power.
I've been watching for 25 years. Yeah, I remember being a kid and we go to these old Chinese video stores where you have to rent like 30 videos. Whatnot, but I'd always remember seeing their posters and be like, ah, Dragon Ball Z!
Excitement levels at the con only went up as Dragon Ball Z lovers lined up to meet and greet with the show's voice actors. Whether you were there to see the stars or buy the merchandise, there was plenty of reasons to attend.
Because it's fun. Why shouldn't people come out here? It's different, it's fun.
A lot of camaraderie, you know, it's something that we all enjoy. You know, we are all brought together by Dragon Ball Z.
Even if you're not even a fan of Dragon Ball, it's such a good environment to be in.
Kamehacon supplied an endless amount of anime entertainment. For About Town, this is Susan Kamya.
To learn more about other fun events at the Convention Center, visit them online at irvingconventioncenter.com.
What happens when the Fort Worth Zoo brings some fuzzy, furry, scaly friends to the library? A chance to take a walk on the wildlife side and learn a lot about animals. Here's a look.
Things are getting wild at the West Irving Library.
We're here to introduce people to these animals and bring some of the zoo to you.
The Fort Worth Zoo brought out some unique animals.
We brought a big variety. So we've got some birds, some mammals, some reptiles. We've got a little bit of everything, maybe even some creepy crawlies. So we like to keep it mixed up. We are going to start off with a really cool one called the Harris hawk. It's a hawk species that we can find right here in Texas. He's a really neat, really unique bird. I think everyone's going to really enjoy seeing him.
And believe it or not, this isn't a baby donkey. Hector here is a completely different kind of species.
That's called a Patagonian cavy. They're also called maras. They're from South America and they're rodents. They're the third largest rodent in the world. So they're related to animals like guinea pigs, mice, rats, porcupines. So they're very, very unique. In fact, we don't even have one on exhibit at the zoo.
The Fort Worth Zoo visit furthered the library's mission to provide a service beyond books and information.
We're aiming for entertainment in our community. We're also aiming to tie in with our collections. We'll recommend books that go along with whatever we're doing. You know, sometimes we do puppet shows, sometimes we do musicians, sometimes we do storytellers, and today we have animals.
And programs like these prove to be beneficial to the community.
It's enriching. It's bringing it to people who maybe can't reach it. And it also exposes our children to a wide variety of different things.
You know, it's so important that kids are able to see wildlife up close in order to gain an appreciation for those animals. And so it's really fun to be able to educate them and let them have that experience of meeting an animal up close, maybe getting a little more personal than you'd be able to get just seeing one at the zoo.
Both children and their parents enjoyed learning about the wild wonders of the Fort Worth Zoo. For About Town, this is Susan Kamya.
Irving Public Libraries kick off this year's Summer Reading Challenge on June 1st, and there will be a lot of great programs like this one at every location. To learn more, visit cityofirving.org/libraries and click Summer Reading Challenge.
The 5th annual Canal Fest returns in June.
And Jasmine Lee brings us all the details. Welcome.
Thank you.
Always great to see you, Jasmine. So I was doing a little bit of research and I went to the webpage and it said that Canal Fest is a way to travel around the world in a day. So tell us what that means in terms of how we're going to do all this traveling.
Well, Canal Fest has always had a lot of different components, but the most popular by far has been our cultural stage. And so because of that, this year we're diving in. That cultural stage has expanded to encompass the entire festival.
Great.
So we'll have 3 cultural stages now.
Wow.
Each stage is surrounded by a variety of activities that fit in with the cultures of that stage. So we have a stage that's representing Africa, surrounded by activities and photo opportunities and exhibits that all have different types of African culture. And we do the same thing with North and South America, Europe, and Asia.
Wow. That's so you literally will be able to go from place to place and learn something new and see something interesting and, you know, and listen to some great music.
And take things home. We've got vendors in every area that are selling things that represent those cultures as well. So you can buy authentic African goods. Russian nesting dolls will be available. Oh, even current culture as well. We'll have some anime-inspired items in the Asia section.
Oh,
so
yeah,
it's a lot of fun.
Yeah,
that's great.
And I know that there's a lot of construction going on in the Irving Center. So what details can you tell us about the venue?
Well, it's historically been on the canal, hence the name. Yeah. However, because of all of that construction, we've moved a few blocks down the street, and the festival will take place right alongside Lake Carolyn at 501 East Las Colinas Boulevard. It's the same place we do our annual fireworks show, so those who attend will be very familiar with the location.
Okay.
Still plenty of parking, and there will be area garages. The list of those garages will be available on the website.
All right, good deal. So definitely check that website. All right, so there's also, I think, when people think, oh, cultural stage, you're thinking everything's for adults.
Yes.
But that's not the case.
Definitely not the case. Each one of our areas has craft activities. The kids can create something and take it home. Create their own African tribal mask, create their own Grecian urn, and things that tie in with various cultures. And there's also some of the staples, face painting, balloons. And so there's so much to do out there for all ages, and people are even welcome to bring their pets. Yeah. The Las Colinas Association is providing a dog watering station at the event.
That's great.
So bring Fido out. Fido can take a look at everything, get some water, and enjoy the scenery as well.
That's great. Wonderful. Well, we are definitely looking forward to Canal Fest again with this sort of a slightly different take on things.
Yes.
And folks, bring your passports because you're going to be doing some traveling. Canal Fest is on Saturday, June 9th. The fun kicks off at 2 and lasts until 10 p.m. in the Las Colinas Urban Center. Visit irvingevents.org for additional details.
This week, we'll take a look at the critically acclaimed new film, Blindspotting.
Like, I was taking notes, and when that scene happened, I, like, dropped this, and I was like, I can't even. That's probably the scene that everybody in the theater was just
gets everyone just
freaking
like,
out.
Something about a little kid with a gun that's just like, ugh.
I didn't even cross my mind that that could happen too.
I know.
Like,
it really could, because we've sort of lost track
of the gun
at that point.
Yeah.
You're like, no.
Exactly.
He was just sitting down. It just came right out of his pocket.
It's so sneaky.
What is this?
Oh. Hey. I would like to get out.
Look at this.
I'm better wearing the glove, though.
Yeah.
I ain't trying to go back to jail.
$200
for Collins. Not Collins' gun.
Very nice. Oh, I just got an Uber pickup.
You got it.
Is this an Uber? Hell yeah.
Tell him, slow down. No, you can't catch me. I'm on too fast on the gas. Don't chase me.
Put him up like this, you can.
I'm a tough guy.
Do me a favor. I got 3 days left on this probation. When you got that gun on you, just don't tell me about it. Plausible deniability.
Oh, do you mean this gun?
Get out.
Good night, Colin.
Yo, bro.
Stop! Stop! Don't you!
I really like the meaning of blind spotting in this movie, like how it's when you only see one thing and you miss something else that's there. Have you guys ever been guilty of blind spotting yourself?
Oh, yeah, all the time. Everyone is. That's why it's such a universal idea that we wanted to include. It's like I don't know that there is a way to exist without blind spots. Mm-hmm. It's just acknowledging that they exist and that you have biases based on your life's experiences. And if we're sort of collectively as a society going to address places where you know, overall we've sort of come about these blind spots, that we have to like acknowledge that they exist and do the work to try and see as much as we can.
I think the interesting thing about the Rubens vase analogy in the film is that it is just a physical, like a brain chemistry thing. You look at that picture and you see what you see.
Yeah.
And so what I think that illustrates is that we all have so much work to do because it's not, you're not consciously choosing to see a thing or to not see a thing. It's just gonna happen. So you have to be really aware. You have to be really aware that there's probably something here that I'm missing, and I should take the time to figure out what that is, and then understand that every time I look at it, my temptation is going to be to do the natural, easy thing and only see what I saw the first time.
You are a convicted felon, Mr. Hoskins. You are now that until proven otherwise.
How?
Prove otherwise at all times.
Not enough. Stop!
Don't shoot, don't shoot! Are
you
with me now?
Said, are you with me now? In fact, it's good in a while. You know, you don't have to act ghetto to hang out here. Can
you
hear me
now? You need to get rid of Miles.
Miles, this is my best friend.
He's gonna put you back in jail, or he's gonna get you killed. Miles!
I do find y'all's friendship in the movie very interesting, too, because, you know, you don't know how to feel about Miles at some points, because sometimes you're thinking that he's a bad influence on Colin, he's going to ruin his life, but then he kind of proves his loyalty, like, throughout the whole movie. And an example of that is also how he's, like, always kind of bashing the ex-girlfriend. I have to ask, like, do you think that should be the rule? Like, when a friend breaks up with a girl, should the ex just be completely hated on?
Unfollow
on social media.
Yeah, I don't know. That's
There's a lot of qualifiers there. Yeah. But, you know, but Miles isn't hating on Val just because she's the ex. He's hating on Val because she broke the rule that Miles holds most sacred, which is loyalty, which is you're never not there for your family. And
that you accept them for exactly who they are. So, like, Val making statements about Colin cutting his hair. Like, for Miles, that is not what happens. And you didn't come visit him in prison. Like, that's not what happens.
It's unacceptable.
It's unacceptable behavior for Miles. But that, you know, Miles' blind spots come into play there, right? He doesn't see or understand all the work that Val is trying to do based on her family history to move herself into a new place socially, right? And that is really important for her and kind of life or death for Val. You know, and I think Janina does such a wonderful job of portraying this character who has made a choice to be hard.
Don't make me write you up for your last week. The judge will extend your time here a year.
That is the life we live in, and it's been since the beginning, and you know we stuck in that soil, loyal. Don't be who you is!
I found it really interesting how Colin was, how he would react to whenever he saw a cop versus Miles, like he was even oblivious to even a cop car nearby. Why was it important to show that kind of comparison in this movie?
I think what we were hoping to do is try to get the audience to understand the innate fear that police provoke to certain people, sometimes more than others. Like you said, like Miles doesn't react in fear. He does try to get them off the street. He is aware of the danger and the problematic nature of police in Oakland. I don't know that he's oblivious to that at all.
Yeah.
But it haunts him differently because the threat is different. And it's so fun to sit in a theater and feel an audience, by the time that scene comes around, feel an audience from all different ages and backgrounds and sexual orientations and what have you. Identify with the fear, because if you can do it in a theater for 90 minutes with a character that isn't perfect, then there's some hope outside of that theater.
Every time you come around, you monsters got me feeling like a monster in my own town.
I ain't no killer.
Check your local listings for theaters and showtimes for Blindspotting.
The Irving Black Arts Council closes their 2017-2018 season with the theatrical production, Juneteenth, the stage play.
Lenita Johnson and Greg Ellis join us with the details. Welcome, you guys.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And it's great to see you both. Greg, I want to start with you because as we were saying just a moment ago, when most people hear the name Greg Ellis, they think football.
Yeah.
And they think specifically Dallas Cowboys
exactly.
football.
Exactly.
But it turns out that there's another side to Greg Ellis. Tell us a little bit about your creative endeavors.
Well, I like doing movies and I like doing plays. My company has produced a movie before, and we have produced a play, and now we're producing our second play entitled Juneteenth, The Play.
I love that. I think that's fabulous.
Yeah, that's great. So Lenita, how'd you guys team up with Greg to bring this show to Irving?
Oh my God, this has been a great partnership. So Greg did the first play. It was called The White Knight Story. Mm-hmm. And it's a historical storytelling. Juneteenth tells the celebration of one of the oldest celebration of the ending of slavery. Mm-hmm. So to collaborate with him and some of the folks here at Irving went to see the other play. We got in contact with him. He got in contact with us. And this is a great way to end our season and to celebrate it right after Memorial Day comes Juneteenth.
Yeah.
So it's a great way to close our season with a bang.
Yeah, absolutely. And 29 seasons.
Yes,
that you
29.
Mentioned earlier.
29.
Yeah, so that means that you're really going to have something, have Greg come back for season 30.
Yes, yeah. I hope he come back again and again.
We're going to try to.
It's a great way. And for kids to know that this isn't just about Texas history. This is American history.
Absolutely.
This is American history.
Absolutely. Well, anytime you put together something like this, that you got to have a good cast to tell your story.
Correct.
Tell us a little bit about your cast.
Well, we had a normal auditions and it took us a while to get the right people in the right places. But finally we did. We didn't pull on any real big namers because I knew the rehearsal schedule would be real rigorous, if you would. So we got mostly local people here and from the Dallas area, and they're really talented though.
Well, I will vouch for the local talent pool in Dallas.
Yeah.
There are some incredible people here. Before, I know Susan's got another question for
okay.
you, but I also want to ask about, there's a VIP event that's happening the night of the event that you've put together as well. Could you tell us about that?
Exactly. Simply, you know, we want to give a little more special attention to people, the time to ask questions. And so we're going to give a special VIP reception, starts at 6:30, letting people in. We're going to enter them in through the backstage of the theater so they'll get to see some stuff and do some early Q&A about what Juneteenth means to them.
I like the way
yeah.
you think.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
that's
there
fabulous.
Great,
yeah.
great.
Yeah.
And Lenita, what do you hope audiences get from this experience?
I hope they learn. I hope they learn a lot about this event, about what happened in history, what really happened. And I hope they get to meet Greg.
Yeah.
Come to the VIP event. He's invested a lot. He, his co-writers, the actors, and for us, the Irving Black Arts Council, that's what we're about, telling the story, getting to know our history, getting to know more and more about our Irving and the Irving community. This is a DFW event, not just about Irving. So I want them to come out, meet us, like Greg say, come in early, go mm-hmm. through the back door, enter,
yeah.
do the question and answer, spend the evening with us.
I think that's fabulous.
I
that's great. So folks, the Juneteenth, the stage play, will take place on Saturday, June 9th at 7 p.m. If you're smart, you'll be a part of that VIP event. It starts at 6:30 p.m. And this takes place at the Dupree Theater. For more details, check out the website irvingblackarts.org.
If you can knit it, knot it, crochet it, or hand tie it, you're probably a fiber fan. The Irving Convention Center was the place for all things yarn and more at FiberFest 2018. Here are some highlights.
An abundance of yarn made the Irving Convention Center pop with color during this year's FiberFest.
I'm a knitter and a crocheter. That's primarily what I do.
My personal preference is I like to knit socks.
I don't go a day without doing something yarnish.
Spinning, crocheting, and knitting were just a few of the things happening at the premier event.
We have lots of vendors and lots of classes going on, lots of knitting and crochet and weaving classes. And we have a lot of vendors that are selling a lot of yarn, tools, and supplies that will help you get to your fiber goals.
A number of vendor booths hope to show off their materials, including the Fort Worth Yarn Shop West 7th Wool.
We have a wide variety of things. We like to carry a lot of local Texas yarn, so we are featuring Madeline Tosh for one. We've got Savvy Skeins as well. They're both out of Texas. And then we've got a lot of different things. We just like to have a variety.
In addition to their booth, West 7th Wool competed in FiberFest's new braid to scarf spinning contest.
They are going from fiber to finished product, and it's a race. So basically right now they're out there spinning fiber into yarn. And then they're going to take the yarn, I believe they're going to weave it into a scarf.
It's just a contest of speed and quality and everything, so it's very exciting. We've got two teams competing, and they're very excited to see what's going to happen.
As you can see, competitors are using treadle spinning wheels. Though this is the more traditional tool, spinning teacher Abby Frankenmont uses an alternative option she and her husband have invented.
I developed ankle tendonitis, which meant that treadling, you know, was really aggravating that. So I needed something that I could do all my spinning on that was wheel specific, that as opposed to drop spindles. The concept behind it is basically just that it should feel like a treadled wheel typically feels, like a really good treadled wheel, but that it should feel like that, kind of very fluid and very responsive, not totally machine-like. I can stand here and spin a lot of yarn pretty quickly and comfortably.
Items like this innovative electronic spinner draws in a big crowd, but it's the friendships that have people returning to Fiberfest every year.
Everyone here has seen each other over multiple years, and we've just kind of formed like a family, and we have a lot of fun. We get a lot of retail therapy here, and then we get to be with our people. You know, we all get to talk about the similar interests and share patterns and share what we like and what we've seen in the vendor hall and everything.
Yeah, just seeing everybody. I'm a little bit of a people person, so I just enjoy being out here.
Fiberfest will be back at the Irving Convention Center in 2019, keeping yarn lovers on pins and needles as they await the new year. For About Towne, this is Susan Conyop.
To get ready for the next Fiberfest, visit dfwfiberfest.org.
The Irving Art Association brings the 33rd annual Texas and Neighbors Regional Art Exhibition back to the Irving Arts Center Main Gallery. Here's a look at the wonderful work of artists from a five-state region and a list of other ways to bring art into your life about town. And here's some fun in the sun happening about town. The final Irving Concert for Kids features the band Hey Lolly, crafts, food, and fun on Friday, May 25th at 9 a.m. at the Irving Soccer Center.
Get your fresh fruit and veggies and other locally grown and made items at the Irving Art Center's Farmers Market. That's 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. on Saturday, May 26th at the Irving Art Center.
Join Irving veterans and their families to commemorate Memorial Day on Sunday, May 27th at the former Irving Library Auditorium. The ceremony starts at 2:30 p.m. and it's followed by a performance of the Silvertones at Veterans Memorial Park.
Lively Point Youth Center invites Irving's teens to an end of school bash on Thursday, May 31st from 1 to 4 p.m. Call 972-721-8255. 800-889-8809 for more information. And that wraps up this edition of About Town. Thanks for joining us.
Please be sure to tune in next time for highlights from the 11th annual Dragon Boat, Kite, and Lantern Festival.
We'll also check out Taste of Irving 2018 and meet some of the artists featured at the 33rd annual Texas and Neighbors Regional Art Exhibition.
We'll leave you tonight with another look at the Irving Concert Series. For About Town, I'm Kathy Whiteman.
And I'm Susan Kamyab. Have a great evening.
You can't be wrong with you. I don't know who the hell.